Hi, everybody, and welcome to this episode of Class Captures. Today, in this episode, I'm going to talk about graphs and the relationships of data that they show. So graphs are super important. They're basically one of the last steps in, they're an important ingredient in communicating the results that a scientist or a researcher has come across during their research. And it allows the sometimes abstract or difficult to understand numeric data be shown visually in a much easier to understand manner. And it helps communicate the scientist's findings. It's a convenient way for us as citizen scientists or student scientists to understand relationships in data that come out of experiments or research projects. Three basic types of graphs that we'll be looking at are: one is a line graph, and this shows changes over time. Bar graphs, these are used to show comparison between items. Just going back a second, example of a line graph might be your height throughout your lifespan. You grow taller and taller and taller, and then when you're a grown-up, you shrink just a little bit. Bar graph, you could show comparisons, like you could take a survey of a whole group of people and see what their favorite topping of pizza is, and you'd have a representation of all these different toppings, and the biggest bar would show the most popular pizza topping. Pie charts are used to show how some large thing is divided up into sections. And in earth science, a common one is showing all the elements that make up the earth's crust, or the percentage of oxygen in the atmosphere, or something like that. Direct relationships are relationships when both values increase. So I'll give you an example, which could be temperature and electricity use. So during the summer, it gets hotter. And when it gets hotter, more people turn on their air conditioners, which use electricity. So when the temperature goes up, more electricity is used. So they're both increasing. That's an example of a direct relationship. And I encourage you to think of your own. An indirect relationship is one where one value increases and the other value decreases. The example I'll use is pollution and turtle population. If there's more pollution in a lake, there will be less turtles that live in that lake because turtles don't like pollution. They'll either die or move somewhere else. So while one value increases, the amount of pollution, the other value decreases, the turtle population. And I encourage you to think of your own example. Cyclic relationships follow a regular repeating pattern. So one good example is the tides. Here in New York, we have the Hudson River, which has a tidal range. Every 6.25 hours, approximately, the tide changes from high to low, and then another 6.25 hours from low to high. And it happens in a regular repeating pattern, and it's predictable. So it's predictable, and it occurs because of Earth's relationship to the moon and the sun. So a lot of phenomenon that occur in the solar system and out in space are cyclic relationships because they're regular repeating patterns. So can you think of an example of something that you could predict that's going to happen in a regular pattern? Like, for example, another example is a moon phase. You could tell what the moon phase is going to be like on your 25th birthday because the moon phase changes in a cyclic pattern. Dynamic equilibrium is something that you see when these graphing relationships are discussed. And it's important to take that phrase apart and see what it actually means. So dynamic means changing, and equilibrium means staying the same. So dynamic equilibrium means that even though change is occurring, the net result is the same. So I would encourage you to think of a high school, right? So think of a high school with 1,000 students. And so each class is about 250 students, four grades, right? So in June, 250 of those students graduate, 12th grade, they graduate, right? Well, you would think, okay, now I have 750 students in the school, right? Well, no, you have 1,000 students because 250 more students are going to come up from eighth grade. So even though the student body is changing, there's an equilibrium that exists in the number of overall students. So a high school, a population of high school would be in a great example of dynamic equilibrium. So I hope this was helpful, and I hope you have a little bit more understanding about how scientists use graphs to show the relationships that they discover in their data. Thanks for watching.